3, 2, 1, cheers, everybody.
Take five, strangers.
Oh, I'm a very impressive person.
Hosting five dinner parties.
I don't have a clue what I'm doing.
Give it a go and taste the food.
Load of shite.
Spice it up with some secret scoring.
Five.
As they compete for a €1,000 prize.
Load of money.
Coming up tonight. Comedy cooking. Difficult discussions.
Yeah. That's my interpretation. So
that's your. That's but that's.
So
what
I think I have to concede.
Tony was talking down to me a bit. It really bugged me.
Like I put my hats off up to anybody.
And stimulating speeches.
For blood and wine are red, and blood and wine.
I just wanted to sleep, like, and I was, and I think it had the desired effect.
There are meant to be 365 lakes in Cavan, one for every day of the year. One man who hasn't bothered counting them all is tonight's host, writer, actor and mortgage broker, Patrick Walsh.
Tonight, it's going to be an Oscar Wilde night, so I don't know what is going to happen, what we can expect at all. I would say expect the unpredictable.
Patrick's wild night will have to beat Monday's host, university lecturer Tony Sheridan.
Bon appetit, I guess.
Bon appetit.
Yeah.
Mainly what I got right on my night was the food. It was dinner party quality.
I'm hoping it's gooey on the inside.
But I don't think I had it as upbeat as I would have liked.
You're not wrong. You only managed 27. Tuesday was the turn of hotel worker Pauline Farrelly.
Ah, I got evicted. Jeepers, I got it.
All went swimmingly until her dessert of baked Alaska turned out to be too frosty for some.
My starter was fantastic. My main course was brilliant. Then it came to my dessert. I was so proud of it. I went, ta-da! But when I went to touch mine, the strawberries were frozen.
It's like a bloody rock. Have you hammered? Give us a hammer, will you?
Pauline's dessert was just hilarious. It would be harsh to say it was inedible, but it was definitely verging on that.
The comedy dessert meant Pauline scored just 24. Perhaps she was distracted by the amorous intent of her guests, especially pub landlady Colette McGann.
I think there's probably a little bit of flirting going on, but it's very subtle.
Not that subtle. Photographer Tonya King is unimpressed.
The flirting last night was outrageous. I think everybody was just lost in Colette's dress.
Oh, I think Colette does like the attention, very much so.
Maybe, but it takes two to tango.
Patrick's not holding back at all. He's letting the innuendos fly. I thought I knew a bit about charm and women, but when it comes to Patrick, I think he's streets ahead of me.
I am dreading Patrick's night tonight. I'm so scared. I think this tonight could be a bit Benny Hill. I think that's what Patrick has visions of, like just chasing us all around the house to music.
Patrick is such a flirt. He really is, like, and he did look sexy last night in the outfit he had on him.
Yeah, he's a hottie, all right. Though at the moment it's less Benny Hill and more the Ministry of Silly Walks.
My evening tonight will be completely different because we're having dinner with Oscar Wilde.
Are we?
Oscar Wilde would be my hero in life, so I'm a massive, massive Oscar Wilde fan, as many people are.
Yes, of course. Time to be cultured. Patrick begins his prep by chopping celery and leeks for the starter. Wild chunky winter vegetable soup. Clever.
Chunky. That strikes me as being somebody being too lazy to chop up the vegetables properly.
Well, I hope they're not too chunky. Like, I just... And this is the man that tells us he can cook.
Soup, that is easy peasy.
You don't know the half of it.
Turnips have already been cut and diced, as has the carrots, so that's my little bonus. Didn't expect that as well. So anyway, we all cheat a little bit.
Especially you. Patrick can, however, be bothered to peel some potatoes and chop onions. Hungry, are we?
When I'm cutting an onion, I'd normally chew a little piece of brown bread and it'll keep the dry eyes. My eyes are watering a little bit, I think, even though I've had a fair bit of brown bread.
That's a triumph, then. Must remember that one.
I'm thinking about poor Oscar Wilde being in jail. Behind my prison, blinded bars, I do possess what none can take away. We Irish We are too poetical to be poets. We are a nation of brilliant failures, but the greatest talkers.
And you're not kidding, are you? Back to the soup, and he simmers the veg in stock.
There's going to be a lovely smell now when my guests come in this evening, so that might make them nice and hungry, and if I can keep bullshit my way through this, I might just win them over. We'll just about get 5 bowls out of that.
Patrick will reheat his soup once his guests arrive. Now he turns his attention to the main course. Surely something inspired by Oscar Wilde.
I chose the main course because it's actually the only course I can cook.
And that is corn-fed fillet of chicken in sour cream with red peppers, sweet corn and jasmine rice.
It sounds like something that I definitely wouldn't order in a restaurant. It's not my type of food.
I wonder why is he calling it corn-fed fillet of chicken in sour cream?
Because that's what it is.
I wonder what's so special about that. Chicken's a chicken, huh?
It just sounds fancy because it's corn-fed fillet of chicken. It's basically a yellow chicken.
It's not that yellow.
Two nice, good, succulent breasts of chicken.
He's off again.
So, you know, that's what we need to get.
Patrick marinates the chicken in lemon juice, ready for cooking later. In keeping with his Oscar Wilde theme, he's asked everyone to come in Victorian dress.
I think Tony will probably wear something tight and revealing, and I think Patrick might do so, because they'll be all out to impress Colette tonight, because they're probably hoping she'd wear something real short.
It's Victorian!
I'm delighted with the dress code tonight. I'll feel very at home tonight.
Maybe he dresses up in Victorian clothes at the weekend. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think we want to know what Patrick gets up to at the weekend. On to dessert, banoffee pie.
Yeah, you know, FFE. Baff, what do you call it? I'm so tired. Why do you pronounce that dessert?
We'll come back to you.
I like the ban bit. I'm not so sure about the offie.
Oh, that is absolutely my favourite one. I wonder, is he making that from start?
Of course he is. Patrick begins by gently heating cans of condensed milk. He breaks up digestive biscuits. Not sure dancing helps. He adds melted butter and presses the whole lot into a cake tin to make a biscuit base.
They've cooled down.
Next, he opens the cans of condensed milk.
Yeah, I think we'll get away with it. So this is an opener.
It is.
I've tried one of these before. I think this is how it works.
Thanks for that.
Now. Ooh la la. Perfecto. Little bit like jelly. But it's okay. I need to spread this around.
Won't that be hot?
Ah, sorry.
Ooh. I did warn you. He adds bananas and cream.
I think it's working out perfectly. Oscar Wilde seems to be shining a light on me so far, so hopefully he'll continue to be shining on me.
Known for his puddings, was he? A dusting of chocolate and some nuts, and the pudding's done.
Finito. Banoffee.
Time to dress for dinner.
I'm going to be terrified opening that front door.
You're going to be on the other side of it.
I don't know what to expect. He could be Oscar Wilde in the nip.
Oh, heavens. Well, thank goodness he's not naked.
One should either be a work of art or wear a work of art.
Shut up and answer the door. First in, it's Mr. Magoo. Oh, no, it's not. It's lecturer Tony.
Ah, Tony.
Good day, gentlemen.
Welcome. Come in.
Here's Patrick's favourite, Colette, who seems to have joined the Salvation Army.
Hello. Welcome, madame. Wow.
How are you?
Welcome. Wow,
the new guy. Thank you.
You went to such trouble and you smell delicious.
Thank you very much.
Go on through. Now, allow me to take your coat, Colette.
Please.
Wow.
Calm down, boys.
Now, don't you look fantastic? Now, and let me take your hat as well.
No bother. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I'll be back into you in a moment.
I think Patrick was very impressed with my outfit. I think if I had to turn up in a bin bag, I would still have impressed Patrick.
Even if you do say so yourself.
Because I'm a very impressive person.
Next in is photographer Tonya, looking a bit nervous. I didn't know Charlie Chaplin did dressage.
Look at you.
Look at you, look fantastic.
Are you taking you up my moustache?
No, you're all right, thanks. you look amazing.
She already knows that. And finally, here's last night's host, Pauline. Where's your crystal ball?
Hello.
Wally, wow, look at you.
You're handsome.
Oh, thank you very much. Come on in.
Wally doesn't like hairy men. You're in trouble.
Hello, darling.
You're gorgeous.
Just, that's it. Well done. Excellent. So look, a toast, ladies, gents, Victorian times into Victorian times, and thanks for coming along. Here's to a really good evening.
Cheers. Thank you.
Cheers.
Coming up, a low blow from Tony.
And I honestly say, and I know you're into art, but to me, it's shite.
He tends to talk at you. He doesn't listen.
His opinions are very strong.
High art from Patrick.
And a man had killed his wife in a crime of passion.
Well, it was Patrick.
Hmm? And dessert descends into farce.
Oh. Here we go, guys, and cheers!
Oscar Wilde obsessed writer Patrick Walsh is throwing a dinner party in a quest for a €1,000 prize. His guests have gone all out with his Victorian dress code.
I'm just going to go and check on the starter now, Pauline. So will you excuse me, everybody,
yeah,
for a moment?
Yeah,
okay.
When I got here, like, Patrick just looked stunning. He really did. Like, he's absolutely gorgeous, like.
The mood is good in the group. The atmosphere seems to be developing. We all seem to be opening up a little bit more, all getting more confident. And I think we're a good group.
Let's hope you can feed them, beginning with your starter. And here it is, wild, chunky winter vegetable soup.
There we go, guys.
Lovely.
There's homemade bread. There's a lovely, yummy butter knife there.
Homemade by Patrick or homemade by somebody else?
Yeah, yeah. A little bit of cheating going on there. Yeah. I think you should really try some of this wine.
That's right. Distract them with some booze.
He'd said it was homemade, but I think it just said homemade on the packet.
We'll toast Oscar Wilde and the beautiful company here tonight. Mm-hmm. The women and the men. And
but mainly the women.
Oscar Wilde evening.
Sounds good.
Cheers, everyone.
Not you, Tony.
Thank you very much for having us.
Cheers. Pauline, you must be Hank Marvin, are you?
I don't know what I am. I'm just a hungry...
Hank Marvin, starving. Come on, Pauline, keep up.
I think the starter was very off-putting by the name, but it tasted lovely.
It didn't look like soup. It looked like baby food.
Where did you get your outfit this evening, Tanya?
Well, I had most of it.
Right.
I just borrowed a top hat and an equestrian jacket and...
Well, this is all very civilised.
I couldn't think of anything.
So you would have been a tight lady then,
yes,
in the 1890s.
I would have been riding side saddle through the fields, yes.
So
yes.
Do you prefer to ride side saddle?
Ah, the old Patrick's back.
You're making me blush now.
Patrick is, he's being a great host and he's being a real gentleman. But he's got in there with a couple of smutty comments. He's got them in there.
What about you, Colette?
Well,
The woman in red.
I have an array of vintage clothes.
Do you, yeah?
Because I dress like this quite often.
Yeah, yeah, it's gorgeous.
In fact, I say people would accuse me of dressing very old-fashioned.
Patrick slipped up with the dress code. I think he's probably a bit disappointed on the lack of flesh.
Oh, I don't know. For his main course, Patrick fries the chicken, then adds baby corn, peppers, a slurp of wine, oh no, that's just for him, sour cream and sweet corn. And there it is, Patrick's main, corn-fed fillet of chicken in sour cream. Silence. Everyone happy?
If I'm honest...
That would be good.
I didn't particularly like it that much. There was nothing wrong with it, but, it wasn't wowing me.
I would have loved more of it, like, because I was really hungry. I didn't really eat much today. And I didn't want to feel, like, greedy or anything like that. Like,
I don't like rice anyway, but I didn't want to be upsetting anybody by not eating. And I didn't want to be awkward 3 nights in a row, so I figured it might be better just to eat it and say nothing.
So, the main's not a great hit, but perhaps Patrick's conversation will be.
Living or dead, who would you have at your ideal dinner party? Say,
yeah, yeah,
five people alive or dead, who would they be? Who would you choose?
Who would I like to get round my dinner table? Do you ever hear the band The Saturdays?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Beautiful
maybe,
girls.
Maybe
yeah.
Dead. Not for the conversation, though. Yeah, yeah.
All of them.
Nah, not for the conversation, though. No, no, no.
For their singing?
For all of them. For their singing, absolutely. For their voices.
Jesus. Yeah. Tony said The Saturdays. I just think that sums him up, really.
just having five of them around the table, and Tony's the only male there.
If I'm honest, you know, I want the Saturdays some good-looking girls at my dinner party, and I'm not going to pretend any different.
I think Tony would be into the trophy girlfriends, the girl that's he's going to walk in with and nearly twirl around in front of his mates. And they'll go, wow, we're so lucky.
So, Patrick, apart from these three wonderful ladies, your gentleman company for tonight, and Oscar Wilde, who I assume would be sitting at your dinner table.
I think he'd be sitting on his knee.
Less insinuations about Patrick's sexuality.
I'd love to have a conversation with John Lennon, Marilyn Monroe, John F. Kennedy.
There you go, Tony, that's how it's done.
I wouldn't have to see them sitting at the table together.
He was one clever guy, Kennedy.
I love talking to Patrick. I really enjoy Patrick tonight. I much prefer this character of Patrick, his Oscar Wilde status. I could talk to him all night.
I would love to have Tony Blair, Prince William, Liam out of Home and Away.
Of course.
I'd love to have them. And the Jedwards. I admire them so much.
Oh, not because of their singing or anything like that.
Is it because of their fringes?
No, they were bullied at school and the mother had to take them out of school.
Of course they were bullied at school. They're fucking idiots.
Hang on a minute.
If I'm at school and someone's like, hi John, hi Edward, I'm going to take the piss out of them. Of course I am.
No, that's only acting for the cameras.
I'm sorry, I love them too.
I
love them.
And from two artistic geniuses to another.
I love Andy Warhol. I really like me pop art, and one of his quotes was, like, art is what you can get away with.
He was so original,
wasn't he? I loved him. Yeah. Even when he was in college, he had a project to do, and he had to have two parts of the project. So he only done one painting, and he came into college and you're supposed to have two pieces done, so he ripped it in half and he handed it to
Warhol,
instead of genius.
Now, I admire his arrogance and his self-obsessedness.
Really?
Yeah. It's a characteristic that I admire sometimes. But can I honestly say, and I know you're into art and you're a photographer and you're creative, but to me, it's shite.
What, art?
No, Warhol art.
I don't see anything in it.
In Warhol.
But that's exactly his point. That's Warhol's point. His studio was called The Factory.
I should pretend that I like things like literature and art because of my role as an academic.
That'd be reasonable.
Modern art, and so I'm not going to bite my tongue on that. I think it's a lot of crap.
I got very frustrated with Tony because I've let Tony and Colette speak about their interests and their passions and what they know about the past couple of nights. And I felt Tony was talking down to me a bit, and it really bugged me.
Art to you, Tony, might be the car you drive, that piece of design.
I'm in love with it, yeah. I'm in love with the design in my car, definitely. Because I do see my car as a piece of art and beauty.
There you go.
And that's my interpretation, so...
I think
I have to concede.
I can see how Tony would see his car as art. I'm sure he's been very creative in his car at loads of times.
I'm fine, and Tony is going out there to be heard. His opinions are very strong.
He tends to talk at you. He doesn't listen.
It's bullshit.
Some of it's supposed to be. It's what you can get away with. And that's, like, I put my hats off to anybody.
Load of shite.
Well, let's see if Patrick's entertainment can stop the bickering.
That's fair.
I'm excited, guys.
Meet Oscar Wilde. Or is it Batman?
In 1885, upon arriving in New York, I was asked, had I anything to declare? And I replied, I have nothing to declare except my genius.
It's all in the delivery, you know.
Patrick's entertainment. Well, it was Patrick.
When I came back to London and its high society...
They're behind you!
The taxman called to my door and he said, I am here about the taxes.
I just love the fact that he got up there and he'd done that, and he's so passionate about Oscar Wilde, and I thought he'd done it really, really well.
Did I particularly enjoy it? Again, I should say that it stimulated me intellectually.
Yes!
But it didn't.
No.
I think Patrick was maybe trying to calm us all down. Maybe he thought we were all a little bit excited. And I think it had the desired effect.
And it came out, and a man had killed his wife in a crime of passion. He did not wear his scarlet coat, for blood and wine are red. And blood and wine...
Oh, you've lost one.
...were on his hands.
Patrick was talking. I seemed to be like, I just wanted to sleep, like, and I was going...
She that was young and fair, fallen to dust.
And then the next thing, everybody starts clapping. Hmm?
After Patrick's cultural interlude, time for dessert. Banoffee pie.
Wow.
I've got a bit of ban and a bit of offy, right? Mm.
And of course, the Oscar Wilde theme continues. First, with presents.
Oscar Wilde was known to give gifts to his friends.
Oh, my.
Whatever.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much. Patrick,
look, he even wrote a book about him.
Oh, this is lovely.
And Patrick's not finished yet.
As I said earlier, to keep the tradition going, you can now kiss the stone because you can't kiss his gravestone anymore. Pauline, would you be first to kiss the stone?
Mm. Oh, he's gorgeous.
Wow,
he's
well done.
I'm beginning to wake up again.
Oh, wow. Look at the shape of those lips. Curves and those
Put
lips.
Him down.
Just close your eyes for a minute.
Oh, dear.
Good man, wow. Look at that. Oh, my God.
There's the Chanel.
Rub that together.
Jesus.
Ah, true love.
Do you think you're kissing Linda there?
Oh, that's brilliant.
There we go. Lend me your other cheek. Give me your cheek.
I suppose we should have seen this coming.
Can I take your neck?
This is getting out of hand now. Wow, taxi!
I think the stone was probably just a bit of a detour back to Patrick's face.
I got Patrick's kiss on the day, and then Tony went to kiss me. Oh, I couldn't put that hairy face near me, so I put my hand in. I could feel the hair on my hand.
I don't care why we were doing it, but I enjoyed doing it. It was a bit of crack.
Patrick's dessert was... just about edible. it was an awful lot of cream.
Tonight, I'm going to give Patrick an 8 because I had a great night.
Patrick was a great host and he was great company, so for that, I'm going to score him a 6.
The food was near enough excellent. The entertainment was very good. And because of this, I'm going to give Patrick an 8.
I think his food wasn't necessarily top class and I personally didn't enjoy his entertainment very much. The effort that went in gets him a well-deserved 8 out of 10.
So Patrick's wild night powers him into the lead with 30 points. Next time...
I've got a little present for you.
Oh.
Unusual gifts.
That's a picture of me.
What was that all about?
Unexpected finds.
Some kind of hair. Oh, the hair did not smell good at all.
And ungrateful guests.
Pauline!
You did not try it, Pauline.
It was a bit of a knife in the heart seeing somebody spit your food out. The kids don't.